A very warm good afternoon to all of you. I'm sorry there has been a little delay from our end. Dr. Chintala was in a meeting with the Honorable Finance Minister. However, we will have him join us very shortly. I would like to thank each one of you for joining us this afternoon for the high-powered plenary session titled Scaling Up Access to Finance for Agriculture, Understanding Demand, Gaps and Innovation for the Next Big Leap. It is my absolute pleasure to invite the esteemed panel for the session. This session will be moderated by N. Srinivasan, International Development Finance and Livelihoods Expert, and the panelists include Dr. Soumya Kanti Ghosh, Group Chief Economic Advisor, State Bank of India, Meera Mishra, Country Coordinator, IFED India, Dr. G. R. Chintala, Chairman, NABARD. He will join us shortly. We have a book release of the State of Agri-Financing in India 2021. We will do that once Dr. Chintala joins. The book is authored by N. Srinivasan and is supported by NABARD. We also have, as a part of our initiative to showcase voices from field, we also have a short clip of farmers expressing their concerns on how, what are the challenges they are facing with respect to access to credit. After the video concludes, I will request Mr. Srinivasan to take charge of the conversation. I request Imran to kind of showcase the video to the delegates, please.
એટલે હું કે સરકાર બાટલે કીધી ના મેરશે એટલે કાંઈ બોલે અમે સેટમેન્ટ લગ જીવું છે અરે લોન બાડી આવી રાનવું છે આની કરી આઈ મન કે ચાસ કરવું છે અરે બાકી દેવું છે ટાકર કાઢવા તો કાઢવા જ બાકી ગોટા રસી જે આટા કામ કાયવું છે એટલે સરકાર બાટલે અરે કાલિયા યોજના બોલવે આટા બી ના પાયવું છે અરે ફસલ બીમા યોજના બોલવે આટા બી ના પાયવું છે એટલે આમ કાને શુનવું છે આમ તો કીજી વિવાડે ના મેરશે છે બેગ તાનો ગલે પણ બોલવા છે આજી આ કાલી આ બાબુ બોલવા છે એટલે કાતક લે અહીં પર જઈ જઈ રોગું એટલે જઈ જઈ રહેલી એ બાદ અમારો ફસલ પણ નષ્ટ હોય છે ફસલ નષ્ટ થયેલા બોલે યાર કાંઈ કરવું હોય કુંલા દાન બોલવાય આ હિસાબને પણ પૈસા આવી છે કાંઈ આવી છે બોલવાય અહીં બાટલે પણ ના આવશે છે
Good morning, all practitioners in agricultural finance, academic scholars, researchers, those who have logged in for this high-powered session on what we do in agricultural finance, what are the gaps, and how we can move forward. We have three people in the panel, all eminent people, Dr. Soumya Kanti Ghosh, who is an economist from SBI, handling all its issues in relation to the economic performance in general and how the bank is dealing with their issues. Then we have Meera Mishra from IFAD. All of you know that this is the only international fund for agricultural development, and IFAD is operating in 177 countries across the world, and India is also a key country for IFAD's portfolio. Then we have chairman of NABARD, who is joining in from his office in Bombay. I think he is held up a bit in a meeting with the finance minister, and he should be joining us shortly. So this session, as captioned, we are trying to look into agricultural finance, how it's moving, what kind of gaps are there, how are we meeting the demand, what are the emerging developments, and what can be some of the ways forward, especially in terms of innovations and new practices being brought in. Just to start off the discussion, I'll give a brief, what do you call it, 2 minute long introduction, in the sense, agricultural finance, there is a lot of it there in the country, but also there is a lot of it not there in the country. Maybe Mr. Ghosh would later on enlighten us on what is this paradoxical situation in agri-finance in the country. This is one of the countries where the regulator and our government, they focused on making access to finance available for farm households. among the developing or the what do you call newly developed countries, probably India is at one of the best parts as far as the extent of outreach has also quantum of credit. But at the same time, we also have issues of regional skew, state-wise skew, disparities between well-irrigated, well-endowed regions and those which are drier and slightly less endowed. And we also have issues of whether small farmers get adequate credit and formal credit, how many people get. I think to set the discussion rolling, I will probably start with Dr. Ghosh. You see, the recent survey on All India Debt and Investment carried out by NSSO, it brought out that about 30% of farm households have access to institutional credit and about 10% have access to informal credit. So overall, the access to credit is still for only 40% of farm households. And the average, the farm household that's actually made investments in the year 2019, the year of the survey, they were only about 43% of households. And the average investment is around 10,000. In today's terms, it's almost nothing. And there is a huge regional disparity. Bihar has only 12% accessing credit compared to Kerala, 39% farmers accessing formal credit. So from your background, SBI does anything very large. Its pilots are mainstream for several other banks. And you are spread all over the country. So what would you think is the general situation of agricultural credit in the country and how as a country we are looking at those issues. So if you could give a perspective for about 5 minutes, then we can go ahead from there.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for giving me an opportunity to speak in this forum. And it's a privilege to speak over here. I think the report which you have speaking about, if I make a passing reference to the report which has been recently published, I think, sorry, that's a very interesting report. And but let me tell you some facts about the, I think, agricultural credit in India. If you actually look into this data, there has been several initiatives which the government of India has taken in the last 7 years. Actually, I was making a list of all of them. So there are several. For example, if you look into the institutional edit for structure, I think the target for the banks has been 13.5 lakh crores for FY20, 15 lakh crores from FY21 and 16.5 lakh crores for FY22. And please note that every year banks are actually meeting the target. So that's the first thing. So in terms of the overall macro numbers, banks have been largely able to meet the agricultural credit with the government setting. Apart from that, the government has also announced an interest subvention scheme. As all of you know, that 2% interest subvention or short-term loans up to rupees 3 lakhs. And the most important thing which the government has actually launched is the, and I will speak to that. I think there is a question also on Kishan credit card later. So I can answer that question later, but I will just touch upon this. The most important part is the Kishan credit card. I think the Kishan credit card portfolio is largely credit card which is given to farmers for renewal at the end of every year in the month of June. Of course, there are some issues which we can discuss related to the Kishan credit card when you come to that point. But let me tell you one important point over here is that the government has been making significant efforts in trying to ramp up the KCC scheme, and therefore, in fact, there has been numbers which shows that from 2014 to 2000, in the last 4 years, if you actually look into the credit which was in the informal segment and has now come back to the KCC segment, we did an estimate and that amount came to around 4.6 lakh crores. The total number of KCC cards in the system, currently active KCC cards in the system, is currently around 6.7 crores. But there was a recent study by NABARD which says that the Prime Minister Kishan beneficiary has 11.5 crores and out of this only 28% is actually linked to the KCC card. So that means that actually explains the gap that why there could be some issues in the institutionalization of the credit in the system. And these are mostly small and marginal farmers. The problem is that, as all of you know, and the government is actually making a lot of efforts in terms of the land records, because we have been making this demand, and now the states are actually doing, and in terms of the Andhra Pradesh has the most model law that if you have a land record, then it becomes easier for a bank to lend to a particular farmer. But if you don't have a land record, then it becomes very difficult to ease. And that's why this KCC Kishan credit card scheme is a very novel way of scaling up, and we have been able to scale up significantly. But if I give you some more numbers over here, I think you mentioned about this household debt report. Yes, I think if I just read out from this report, the total average amount of debt for the rural sector was around 60,000 crore, and for the urban areas were around 120,000 crore. We actually did an analysis to find out that what could be the average amount of debt which it could have happened maybe in 2021, and we can see that there has been possibly the debt has actually may have increased 1.5 times from this 2018 levels. This is based on the current trends and the pandemic. But the good thing is that, and here actually I will end over here, is that yes, there is an element of non-institutionalization of credit in the agricultural credit system. But let me give you some numbers. Is that over a period of 1971, if you go into 2018, which is the latest one, in 1971, 71% of the total credit was non-institutional. Today, this number is at 34%. In 2012, this number was at 44%. And in 1991, it was actually at 36%. So in between, there was an increase in this share of non-institutional credit, which has started to significantly go down. And interestingly, as all of you know, why this share goes up? Because this share goes up in years of agricultural distress. And there is always a correlation with a loan waiver, which has been announced by several states beginning 2014, the 3 years. So whenever a loan waiver starts, and given the fact that states don't have the fiscal capacity to pay back the entire outstanding loan to the banks in one go, they spread it over a period of 2 to 3 years. Until and unless the entire account is not classified as a performing account, what these people do, they are not eligible for the Kishan credit card renewal. They go to the non-institutional sources, and there actually the share of non-institutional credit goes up. Fortunately, the share is started to come down. I think right now the share is could be possibly less than 30%. But yes, and the performance across states are actually significantly divergent. For example, in a state like Andhra Pradesh, 64% of the farmers there is a non-institutional source as per 2018 survey. While for a state like Assam, this number is only at 12%. Even for a developed states like Maharashtra, this number is 41%. Then this number is significantly higher for states like Orissa, Telangana, even West Bengal. And all these states have witnessed significant amount of farmer suicides also. So if I take all these factors into account, if you look into the overall agricultural credit, which has been given by the finance ministry to the banks have been largely able to do it. We can discuss the dynamics of how it has been attained in terms of the KCC when you come to that point. But there is an element of non-institutionality, yeah, which of course we are trying to, is getting reduced over a point of time.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh, for saying it is, maybe there are gaps, but it is not alarming. Banks are doing quite a lot of work on this through several means. And also the reliance on non-institutional sources, it is declining. So we are seeing progress there. At this stage, let me welcome Dr. Chintala, CMD of NABARD. Thank you for participating, sir. While I give you a couple of minutes to settle down, I am asking the first question to Meeraji to talk about what is her impression of the state of agricultural finance in the country, because they have a perspective from slightly above the ground. Yeah, Meeraji. Hello. Meeraji, are you online?
You are muted, Meera.
Yeah. Thank you first and foremost for inviting me to the panel discussion, and let me apologize that I have an extremely bad connection today, so I will be switching off my camera, otherwise I might drop out altogether. So greetings to my fellow panelists, and then let me switch off my camera and speak so that I don't drop out. Mr. Srinivasan, in terms of the general understanding of the state of agriculture financing, I think Dr. Ghosh has spoken so much in terms with hard data and numbers, and the overall figures also. It is true that institutional finance is increasing, and dependency on non-institutional forms of lending has decreased. It is also something that we see through our work within the communities. What is interesting is that year after year we see that the government is very keen that farmers should have access to more and more of institutional finance. That every time in the budget there is announcement for different types of loans and facilities for farmers to benefit from. We are also aware, all of us who work with communities are also aware that farmers' decision to invest is influenced by the type of access they have to various forms of financing. So indeed, there is a great demand for different kinds of loans, small loans and short-term loans and long-term loans by the farmers. And yet there is a big gap, and this is where we really need to understand, and these are actually more questions than answers from my side, whether the sources of institutional finances are really inadequate, or is there just a regional disparity? The other question is that states that are better off, like Kerala, continue to have a giant share of the institutional finance for the farmers, which makes us wonder that the poor continue to remain more deprived. And what is it that is lacking in the system? What more do we need to do that the poorest and the most marginalized, the ones who are already deprived, don't continue to be exploited by money lenders and get.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I got disconnected. Yeah.
No problem.
Yeah. And then, what we also find that there is a need to help bring up some of these states, a specific strategy to work with the farmers, with the smallholder farmers in these states that are not performing well, to see that they can have access to more formal kind of structured loans. But there is also, in our understanding, absence of adequate instruments to manage risks, which would help banks to online further. And there is to some extent, agriculture finance is relatively new. For the longest time, banks have focused a lot towards SHG lending, and just as they geared up to do that, and this became quite well accepted within the banking systems, there was this new animal called FPOs, and now lending to FPOs and all that started. So yeah. I think there is also some kind of a lack of expertise of financial institutions in managing different kind of agricultural loan portfolios, which needs to be looked at from the side of the banking systems themselves. So I'll stop here and hand it back to you.
Yeah, Miraji, I think you are just pointing to the skew, both in terms of the well-endowed versus not so well-endowed farmers, regions, then some states having higher levels of poverty, maybe lower access to, and Mr. Ghosh also dealt with that, saying what incremental things need to be done. The FPO question, maybe we'll broach it slightly a bit later. I turn to you, Dr. Chintala, now. You have the responsibility to look at agricultural credit in its totality and the entire support systems, investment in agriculture, for agriculture. So how would you describe the current state in which agricultural finance is placed? Is it in a happy place? Is it in an okay place? And how do you think we are?
Thank you, sir. First of all, I apologize for joining late, as we were in the budget consultation in the other VC, and it just finished maybe a few moments before we switched on to this one. So good night. But otherwise, I think situation is not that grim as what everybody thinks about the agricultural finance. When I look into the entire agricultural financing, maybe from the historical perspective, in case if 1970, hardly 0.4% of this ANBC was the agriculture lending. And in the next 42 years, that is by 2003, it has reached close to around 56,000 crores. But since then, actually that agricultural credit has grown by leaps and bounds because of the governmental interest. I'm not saying that interest have been. Government has taken quite a keen interest that every farmer should be adequately given the credit kind of a thing. So now, the first intervention was the doubling of agriculture credit from 56,000 crores within 3 years. They wanted it to double, but it went up, doubled within 2 years. So, but subsequently, from 2007 onwards, I think with a little bit of that interest subvention introduced by the government of India, and that has incentivized the commercial banks in a big way to come into the agricultural financing. So now that is why, if I look into it, because I'll take only a decade old kind of a data, that is in 2011-12, the entire credit crop loan given was around 3.96 lakh crores. With a term loan of around 1.14, that is the total is around 5.11 lakh crores in 2011-12. And it's increasing by such a pace that now today, and that is the last year, I think we have given close to 15.78 lakh crores. So that is phenomenal. And if you look into again the institutional kind of a share in this one, almost close to 80-81% is given by the commercial banks, which were not, who were not the players at one point of a time, but they really took quite a lot of an interest. And the second thing is the cooperatives and RRBs, they continue to maintain their share continuously, even though the volumes wise it may not be the same, but at the same time they are maintaining the share. So now they are 12%. So in that way, I feel that quite a lot of a credit is being given from the institutional source. And the second thing, everybody asks, where exactly this is going? When we were looking into the data, we found at one point of a time, whatever be the credit, actually it was going to a large farmers or the medium-sized farmers, and the small and marginal were almost out of the radar of the formal system. But today, the entire Indian agriculture is dominated by 86% of the farmers are the small and marginal. And you look into the statistics, actually almost maybe 90% of them are getting the credit from the institution. So now that itself is a big salutary kind of a thing, which I can say that the institutional finance is doing. And also the role of money lenders, informal sources have gone down substantially. And interest rate rationalization, actually this is one thing which everyone has to notice, is that earlier usurious rates were there, and today actually the most of the farmers, whosoever is tagged to the institution, up to 3 lakhs, they are getting between 4% to 0%. Now that is how actually that is very good. And the other one is actually a good other development that is happening is that for sustaining agriculture, actually there should be a private capital formation at the farm level. And so now the farmers have to invest on that their own agriculture turf. At one point of a time, it was a very meager, but I think the sustained effort of the government and also the institutions like NABARD, RBI and everyone, it is growing up, and now from almost 10-15%, today, last 2 years, if you look into the data, it has gone up to 40%. Now people are investing in the tractors, bore wells, maybe the fisheries, or for that matter, animal husbandry or any kind of thing. So now, that is, so the situation is very good. And one point what Niraj was telling that regarding maybe the Kerala and other things, actually, though there is a, yeah, I'm not denying that actually that some part of the money, extra money is going to the southern states. That is because everybody asks the same question. I say that the institutions are very robust in those states, and the repayment ethics are also very high. So that is why both the things as a, have a good kind of effect on this one. But the North Indian, if you look into it, the North and east and also the western countries, actually they are also doing quite a lot. Actually, they are not that badly performing all this. If you look into the 40% or 43% of the entire credit is going to the southern five states. Remaining states are getting the 60%, and most of them, wherever the institutions are reasonably strong, they are getting it. So in that way, I feel that it's not a very bad thing that is happening. So now our job actually as a sector builder and also the ecosystem builder, we are trying to improve the institution's capacity to deliver the credit, whether they are the cooperatives or RRBs in those things. And if you notice, last year and this year also, we made some kind of a special effort. Even though the institutions are not complying with some of the requirements of getting the refinance, actually, we made a slight relaxation so that the concessional finance will go everywhere, that inclusiveness of the entire country, actually, we are trying to do it. And now the concessional finance of both LTRCF and the SCO is being given to these states where which were otherwise not eligible to get that kind of a concessional finance.
Thank you, Dr. Chintala, for that, bringing the point in that where the institutions are robust, where there is a fairly evolved credit culture, credit tends to flow more. So this also points to the need for how do we build the institutional strength in other states as a preliminary effort before volume of credit can substantially increase. I think it's a very important aspect of what we are going to discuss. I'll turn to Mr. Ghosh now, Dr. Ghosh. We are seeing that in terms of how the, what do you call, commercial banks have gotten involved, like Dr. Chintala pointed out, from almost no share to a very major share, consistent with their size of operations, commercial banks have taken up, especially public sector banks. But if you see the last 4 year data, the emphasis to be more on term crop loans, and more on expanding the KCC kind of coverage, which encourages more a short-term focus to what agriculture is going to do. As I said in the opening statement, investments in agriculture seem to be declining. And maybe the farmer don't have adequate resources of a long-term nature to do that. So what's happening there? Is it that banks think if you give a short-term loan and recover it faster, PSL credit, targets remain fulfilled, and then this is the easier way of doing things, or there are some fundamental aspects that we are missing somewhere?
Credit flow. If you look into the October 22nd data, the total ACV credit to agriculture and allied activities were outstanding at around 13.5 lakh crores. And this year, the year-on-year growth rate is actually more than in double digits, 10%, when all other sectors are showing actually a growth rate of less than 10%, only at the personal loans. Now, the important point to that is that the public sector banks, credit to agriculture and allied activities is more than 60% of the total bank credit to agriculture and allied activities. So that actually explains the agriculture credit. But interestingly, if you look into the KCC in flow terms, I'm not talking in terms of stock terms, because KCC credit was the mainstay of agricultural credit 9 to 10 years back. But recently, there has been a fundamental shift. And if you look into the KCC credit in incremental flow terms over a year, that's only 3% of an PSB's bank credit. So basically, this means that banks have been diversifying from the KCC portfolio. There are other areas and whereby, for example, the agricultural startup, for example, in our bank also, in some of the public sector banks, which we can, which have time, we'll discuss, are actually tying up with these agricultural startups for on-lending. There are also co-lending activities they are doing. But KCC is now only a part of a mandate which the banks has to fulfill every year. And here also, as another chairman correctly pointed out, if you look into the data in terms of the KCC part credit outstanding, let me give you some startling numbers. Overall, this number is only 1 lakh crores, even though the limit can go up to 3 lakh. The total outstanding is 1 lakh. Punjab has a number which is 3 lakh. And states like Chhattisgarh, total KCC part credit outstanding is only 50,000 rupees. And all states like, for example, states like Maharashtra, Telangana, Assam, these numbers are actually lower than 1 lakh. So this clearly shows, and in these states, Unfortunately, for example, Maharashtra's agricultural Uttar Pradesh, the average agricultural GVA growth was 2.7% over the period of last 8 years. But in Punjab, this number is only 0.7%. So we have a paradoxical situation where the KCC outstanding is actually larger in states where the agricultural growth rate is low, and in lower in states where the agricultural growth rate is actually higher. So there is a fundamental problem in terms of how this loan reaches the small and marginal farmers. I gave you a figure. This was as per a NABARD study that out of 11.5 crore farmers, only 30% of the farmers have linked to KCC. The first task of the government is to scale up this KCC so as to at least cover the small and the marginal farmers. And the second thing, which actually will ask you a question in terms of whether it needs to go to investment. Yes, it needs to go to investment, but I'm glad to say that today there is an element whereby the agricultural credit is also being getting to the agricultural startups for on-lending activities. And the final thing is that we need some fundamental shift in the KCC operations by the Reserve Bank of India and maybe also by the government. We have made this demand to the Reserve Bank of India. I think basically making the KCC portfolio are very flexible, which in terms of an maybe a portion of that could go to a revolving credit, and a portion could be credit repayable over a period of 15 years at a simple rate of interest. We did an estimation of this one, and we are happy to say that this actually led to an 25% to 30% increase in the income of the farmers on a monthly basis. So there are ways to go about improving this KCC scheme and operationalized scheme. But my point to note is that I'm glad to say that banks have started to move away from this KCC, even though the mandate is that at the end of the day, all the small and marginal farmers who are getting benefits under Prime Minister Kishan scheme, which we could take as the benchmark, should have a KCC account with the bank.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh, for that clarification on the direction that banks are now taking. Yeah, KCC will be there, but we want to do more investment credits, and average loans in several states are not very high in KCC. Other means are being chosen. Dr. Chintala, I have a connected question, which also is about the NABARD refinance. If you all remember in the 80s, major part of the 90s, it used to go for project loans, investment credit, investing a lot of time in trying to examine the linkages for each project proposal. And then it was a kind of a passionate kind of an involvement in development in agriculture, so that the productivity enhancers, productivity enablers are financed. So production increases, farmers gain benefits from there. But NABARD's refinance portfolio, of course, is growing by leaps and bounds each successive year, thanks to the efforts of you and your entire team out there. Even NBFCs are getting covered now. But is the passion for long-term investments in agriculture continuing to be there, or it now seems to be more like, okay, some more money has to be given to these banks, and then there is not that kind of a projectization effort? What is that we need to look at in this space, if at all?
Yeah, thank you, sir. It's a very valid question. But now, as you are telling, once upon a time, actually, we were having all these kind of things, creating a project lending, appraising the projects and doing all things. Afterwards, it has become an auto kind of a thing. So in that way, maybe we are looking into just giving the money to the sector and maybe not looking at each and every project which used to come to the regional office and see really where exactly these projects are going. Though, as you are rightly told, that now the by leaps and bounds, the refinance is growing and it is going to the appropriate sector. But at NABARD level, we are not having that kind of a granular data, exactly really who has appraised the project with what kind of efficiency and all those things. So now that is one. But the other thing, actually, there is a little bit of a shift that had happened. Now you told the project appraisal. Now, a good amount of infrastructure now is being created under the government's programs, like that RADF. Now, that earlier, most of the projects, when you were there in the bank also, what we used to do is that maybe minor irrigation is that individual pump set schemes we used to address. Now, today, all these kinds of things are happening in the government at the government level. Now, we get such kind of an RADF projects. Suddenly, government of particular state say that they want to go for some 1,000 community tube wells which each tube well will irrigate something around 15 or 20 hectares, and a group of around 10-15 farmers are part of it. And there will be a kind of a solarization of that one, and there is a convergence of everything. So that kind of a things are happening. And also the government is creating quite a lot of infra with regard to irrigation structures, normal medium irrigation projects, canals, then giving the drip irrigation also now part of this kind of an RIDF they are taking. And the other one is that the solarization of the pump sets is going in a big way, like Haryana, Chhattisgarh and others. They are borrowing money under RIDF to do this. Otherwise, earlier it used to be the individual financing which we used to do. Then the third one is with regard to creating the connectivity, markets and the warehousing, which earlier, even when we are doing the project appraisal, actually all these three things were out of bounds of NABARD. Actually, we never used to do things on our own with regard to the connectivity, markets and warehouses. Today, with this RIDF, WIF or any kind of thing, where we are also part of that appraisal team and doing the things, quite a lot of things are happening. Actually, we created maybe millions of tons of storage space with that kind of a funding, and maybe lakhs of hectares of irrigation has been created. A lot of drip irrigation has come into the system. A lot of solarization has come. So now those things are happening. But at the same time, still we are, I think we have to do a little more with regard to capital formation at the farm level. And for that, probably we may have to reinvent our designs. And say that probably again that project approach which we used to do, if a particular individual farmer wants to start a poultry farm or a dairy farm or a fisheries farm or maybe even that time, the kind of a thing, if you do it, actually this will have two major impacts. One is our maybe capabilities and also the ground level connect will be very high. And second thing is the institutions which are our collaborators, all the commercial banks, cooperatives, RRBs, they look at our appraisals and they will also take a cue. Actually, this particular area, there is a scope to expand this particular activity, and they can also do it. It can become area development. Now, what we have done in the last 1 year is that we have done two major changes. One is that integrated farming systems, which we made as a kind of a new approach where we are giving that kind of a models to the farmers and seeing that all the DDMs and also bankers are also owning that kind of a thing. And this is one. And the next one is the FPOs. Now, this is one actually FPOs. I don't know where you would like to classify it. Is it an investment credit or it is a maybe a grant-based kind of thing? But at the same time, to my knowledge, at one point of time, it is a grant-based approach which we have done, but subsequent, it is like investment credit. So now, there actually quite a lot of fundamental shift is happening, and the rating tools which we have evolved and what our subsidiaries are doing, which I think we have, can transfer it to the other banks. Already with IBA, we gave. So now, that is one area which we have to concentrate further. And also, one thing which actually, I don't know really how far my observation is true, when Soumyakanti Ghosh was telling that there is a diversion from that, or maybe a thing from the KCC to the other activities, whether it is the maybe startups or anything. I feel actually that the number, the quantum of money that is going to the KCC or that crop loan is not making any, not undergoing any change. Actually, that is remaining same or going by 10%. But the banks are going into a little higher trajectory also by putting the maybe FPO financing and the startup financing, so that the pie is getting expanded rather than maybe it is eating away into the KCC or the crop loan. So that it is a very happy situation now. The banks are diversifying the agriculture portfolio from the typical crop loan and the KCC loan to the new generation kind of activities like the FPOs and the startups and all those things. So it's a welcome step. So I don't know whether my observation is correct or not. Actually, if I look into the statistics, there's absolutely no reduction in the crop loan, whether it is a KCC loan or maybe out of KCC, the crop loan. Crop loan is growing at the rate of 10%, but the other activities are growing. So that is a very happy situation. That's what I feel.
Thank you, Dr. Chintala, again for bringing the nuances of what's happening on the ground. While there is a need for strengthening the capital formation on farm, for which we may have to again get into some kind of project mode, the point is also that several small individual retail investments, especially in irrigation and those aspects, they are getting clustered and government does larger program, and the kind of funding that goes there probably is a substitute for the minor irrigation development which used to take place earlier on individual farm. Your example of tube wells, I can also add the minor micro irrigation project you have in Gujarat, Telangana. I think, yeah, on the FPO side, maybe we'll discuss a little bit later one more round of questions. Miraji, I just wanted to get to you again. The multilateral organizations have been doing several projects where there is a provision for bank credit linkage. Traditionally, most projects, they have done very well on everything else except where the bank credit interface is involved for the multilateral project, IFAD or World Bank. If it's a pure credit line given to a financial institution, that normally gets done. So IFAD knows the MRCP, which it implemented through NABARD, or the National Microfinance Project that it did through SIDBI. They were fully implemented. But other projects where there is a provision for a bank linkage, what has been your experience? Did it happen well? Did the connect really happen? And how would you look at that? And what kind of roles that multilaterals could have played in ensuring the linkage takes place, even when the country is full of banks providing credit?
Yeah. Thank you, Srinivasanji. Let me go back to something that Dr. Chintala said in the beginning of his remarks about why some states tend to get are more successful in getting bank links, which is the importance of strong community institutions, and therein also lies some of the answer to the question that you have asked. So you see, what we have been talking about so far, one of the biggest challenge in getting the bank linkage in terms of the agriculture finance, whether it is from commercial banks or NBFCs or now the new banks, is essentially the lack of confidence that these financing institutions have in the farmers' ability to use the funds productively and to repay the loans. And because of this lack of confidence, they are reluctant to give the loans to many first-time borrowers, many first-time farmers. And that is why those who have never borrowed, the poorer states, the poorer farmers, continue to struggle to be able to benefit from the system, whereas others who have a good credit history are able to benefit from here. And and this is where I think that the role of multilateral agencies, the IFIs, rests to some extent. And IFAD amongst the IFIs does a few things which I think can be seen as a good practice. One is, and there are some good experiences, be it in Tamil Nadu, be it in Maharashtra, even in states like Odisha and Jharkhand, which is to build a strong community institutions with very robust governance structures, which have regular audits, which have a strong MIS that capture the transactions, that can capture the credit history of all members, make data available online, all the things that are necessary to give the banking institutions the required confidence to give loans. Because sometimes these information just stay put within the groups, or the groups are not strong enough, or their governance systems are not very robust. The other things that these institutions, these IFIs do, is also then work with the farmers to build their capacity to utilize these loans productively by, helping them to prepare business plans, provide them access to various kind of inputs, including technical advisories, as well as help them, with the services post-harvest, linking them to markets, etc. Which means that every bit of loan that they take becomes productive, and they are able to convert it into good income, and their ability to repay is therefore high. And then something else, for those farmers who have not borrowed in the past and do not have credit history, some things that these projects have been able to do, projects like IFAD have been able to support, is provide small grants or seed capital or revolving funds. And now, of course, with NRLM, government has been doing it also for the past 10 years, which is, you know, to provide these small amounts of funds to the groups to help build their financial capability and credibility, so that they can start borrowing and returning loans within the groups and develop some kind of fiscal discipline within the groups and some kind of small, you know, credit history within the group itself, which would give the bank some confidence. Also, one thing that we should not forget is some of the distant farmers in remote areas need special assistance, this is also an area where IFIs pay special attention. IFAD has also been working some interventions to provide technical assistance facilities to banks, you know, working closely with banks themselves. And more recently, we have been working with creating innovative financial products such as risk sharing facilities with the banks to help facilitate, agriculture finance for
small. That, Neeraj, I'll come to you in the next question. I want to ask you about some of the innovative approaches and think that I think IFAD projects are done differently. I'll draw on your experience a little bit later on that. I want to join up your answer with a question to Dr. Ghosh again. Neeraj is pointing out that one, giving finance to farmers by the banks, they do. But then there are many first-time borrowers, very small borrowers, who require some capacity and some confidence. And also the local community institutions, if they are there, can we strengthen them in order that they can support? Like in the case of SHG lending or in the case of microfinance, where group-based approaches have worked. This is one set of issues. Can the banks actually do this? The second is about the number of new things that are happening on the ground. You also referred to startups, agri-techs, fintechs, which work in the rural areas. Then the FPOs have come up as an aggregator of farm-level demands. There is a lot more discussion about value chain-based approaches in financing. So you take a commodity route to financing the entire chain. Are these merely discussion issues, or these are passing fads which take our mind away, or these are sustainable approaches which the bank can actually adopt? Do you see any significant movement towards this in the sector?
No, yes. I think this is a very interesting question which you asked me, because as I have said recently, and if you actually look into the share of the KCC, the term loan, the credit problem, the problem is actually something which you have to give every year, and then that has to be extinguished as per the RBI norm. So we had made a couple of suggestions that we can discuss it if we have time to revamp the agricultural sector. But let me tell you that I think the banks are trying to undergo a significant transformation in terms of the agri credit. As all of you know that in the Atmanirbhar Bharat, there is a 1 lakh fund has been set up. And that fund is basically, the banks are trying to see how they can explore their credit option in accordance with that fund. In terms of the FPO, for example, is a significant opportunity, and we are also engaging with the FPOs, because the government has given a lot of initiatives the last 3 to 4 years to beef up these FPOs. The other important thing, and which is so much important, is the existence of startups. I will give you some data. The country currently today has 3,116 registered food and agricultural startups, which are growing 25% to 30% of the annually. And some of these startups are also became, quite big in terms of the unicorn and a very good success story. Most of these startups have emerged over the past 5 years, and at least 500 have crossed the proof of concept stage. So you can understand what is the type of evolution which is happening in the agricultural tech startups. There was a study in 2019 which says that the overall market for agri-techs, I think it was done by a consultancy firm, but if I just look into the figures at face value, the total target market for agricultural tech in India is actually more than US$350 billion, but the combined revenue of all food and agri startups in India is not even $100 million. So you can understand ki what is the potential to which these agricultural startups can go, and actually our bank is trying to engage with all these startups, and these startups are in the various form, for example, data analytics, marketplaces, livestock management, novel farmer systems, and the sectors is also witnessing significant amount of capital inflows. Do you know that since 2014, the sector has got close to 17,000 or 18,000 crores of capital inflows. So this sector is, I think, is booming, and the banks has to take advantage of this one. In fact, one of the recommendation we have said that the RBI could come up with a circular whereby it mandates all banks that a part of the agricultural portfolio could be mandated towards to this co-lending or with these agricultural startups. There are, several agricultural startups. I can tell some of the name. For example, Jai Kishan is one of them. Then farm management, crop insurance, crop in one of them. Agri input marketplaces, AgroStar, Ninja Cart, Future Farms. I think a lot of you may have heard the name of all these things. So finally, to cut the long story short, there are examples of public sector banks who are engaging with this. One of the examples which comes to my mind and written is that of Canada Bank, who has invested heavily with and post-harvest agricultural technology startups, which has 450 FPOs to work with and close to 350,000 farmers. So yes, there is an opportunity, and there is also an opportunity of this integrating the entire value chain. As all of you know that there is an element of the problem of price discovery in the rural sector, and that's why there has been so much demand about guaranteeing. So I would like to end here by saying that this INAM also, the initiative the government has done, which is now close to 2 crore farmers, can also be integrated with the overall scheme of objectives that the banks are trying to do. So there are opportunities, and I hope that in the next 1 or 2 years, bank will try to scale up these opportunities to a significant scale.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh, for a very comprehensive answer about how banking system is looking at these opportunities. Dr. Chintala, I know what's coming to you now on value chain financing. Should there be a leadership role that NABARD takes? Because in the early days of projectizing agricultural finance, NABARD played this role, training bankers, putting out advisories, and the sector-wise, whether it's animal husbandry, livestock, irrigation, farm mechanization, it used to provide such a lot more background information of what these investments entail, and looking at how do you examine investment proposals and also work their viability, sustainability aspect. This is one part of it. The second, of course, I know NABARD is an acute player in startups and trying to fund them. And the FPOs, you have, as you already said, the subsidiaries do significant amount of financing. So is it worthwhile to look at consolidating all these experiences, trying to bring the banks together? Like Mr. Ghosh said, banks are interested, they are doing so much. So bring some knowledge and also some capacities in HR among banks. So how would you look at NABARD's potential leadership role in this?
Yeah, it's a very good, maybe at least a question for the leader. So definitely. No, I was going through the entire, maybe the conversation, and also generally we look into the various data points as to what is happening with regard to a financial inclusion. Now, actually, if you can transport that financial inclusion kind of a developments onto the farm sector, I think some of the fundamental things which actually both Meera and Ghosha was answering actually the question. Now, in some places or some geographies where unfortunately the institutions are bad, actually the farmers are not getting the loan and they are maybe pushed to go to somewhere else. Now, can we really put this kind of a jam trinity into the farming sector as such? Create their credit history. Now, in the case of financial inclusion, really how we are doing actually the transactions done by this poor man or woman in the financial inclusion space. Whatever he is getting, 5 or 10,000, if they are able to transact properly, actually the entire history is being created on that web itself, and the data is putting in one place, and their entire transactions are going to the CIC, the credit history is being made. And now the aggregators have come. Actually, they are able to aggregate the entire data and trying to create that kind of a data, push the data into the mainstream bankers, saying that actually these people are good. Now, when all these things are happening in that financial inclusion space, generally these financial inclusion beneficiaries are not farmers. Generally, we keep the farmers away from the country. So now, here, actually, that a parallel to the entire SHG or this kind of financial inclusion, the joint liability pool, actually, which we have created in Abad, and today we have got more than 10 million joint liability groups in the country, which are getting close to around 1 trillion rupees of credit from the banking system without any kind of a collateral. So now, when the social collateral and also the transaction histories are maybe the record, which can give a kind of a credibility to that beneficiary, the similar kind of thing can be given to the farmers. So actually that even the farmers in that geographies, which are very bad for them to get the institutional loan, I think we can do this one. So this is one area which I would like to say that now a work has to be done as a leader and also maybe as a kind of a collaborator with everything. So this is the first one. Then the next one is with regard to the value chain financing. Actually, it is very, very good. Now, today, value chain financing was there even earlier also before the FPOs were invented. But thing is, that was going in a kind of a trade credit or some kind of thing. Nobody was even bothered about. But today, the similar kind of thing, if the warehouse loan is being given by the commercial bank to a kind of a warehouse owner, which in turn will be passed on to the customer, the fellow who is putting the produce. Actually, that is got a value chain. Well, likewise, actually, so many things, whether it is input suppliers or maybe anybody, logistics suppliers. So now, this value chain financing has acquired a real new dimension. And in case if we say that agricultural credit, that is the crop production and also the basic production, crop as well as the investments, still investments happen. If that scale is around 16.5 lakh crores, this value chain financing will be much, much bigger than this one. Actually, that is where I think now some kind of a scoping has to be done. Even today, there is absolutely no credible data as to really what exactly is required by this one. Now, the third one is really who are going to the beneficiaries of this value chain financing. One is, earlier, the value chain financing was basically the trader or maybe somebody who was the village level aggregator was the value chain beneficiary. But today, FPO itself is a value chain beneficiary. Now, these are the people who can get at every stage, right from input sourcing to maybe the mobilization of the operations, to creating the insurance product on a kind of a value chain, then subsequently bringing the maybe the kind of a drones or such kind of a technology which can really do the entire pestilence surveys, sprays and everything in such a way. There also the value chain financing can be done to them, actually due to the drone owner, and that in turn will be passed on to the customer so that they will do it. So now, then the next one is with regard to the aggregation at the primary level, preliminary processors, then subsequently the one who is going to supply to the ultimate one. And in the whole of the system, if you look into it, there are at least some 5, 6 or 7 players who requires the value chain financing, which is above, over and above the crop loans the banks are doing it. So that is where I think we have to do it. Now, we are trying to look into it. Naturally, our subsidiary NAPKISAN is doing already around 800 FPOs. We have done the financing. But it is actually, as you are telling, that now everybody is trying to understand this new animal as to really how this value chain financing is going to behave. But there's a quite a lot of not only money, and quite a lot of synergies can be brought in case the value chain financing can happen in this. And here, as we are telling, instead of everybody competing and trying to jack up the interest rate, if there is a kind of a TREDS kind of a platform, because that is my view, if a TREDS kind of a platform is there, where if you look into that one, TREDS platform is somebody is raising an invoice, put on the TREDS platform, whosoever gives the highest interest rate, that is the, he is the one who can finance it. The similar kind of thing, if it is done, there will be a lot of democratization. And the beneficiary, the end beneficiary will get a very high amount of benefit out of this kind of a thing. So he will get a very cutting edge rates for his kind of a loan. And that is where actually we have to do. Now, NBFCs are doing on their own right now. Mainstream banks are yet to come into this one in a very big way as a kind of a product. And NABARD, as you are telling, actually, we have to take a leadership role, definitely. And we have to work on it in a much bigger way. And here, I would like to put a little bit of the startups. Now the startups also can become part of this kind of a value chain financing. Now whether it is Jai Kisan or maybe Kushtantra, actually NAB Ventures, actually our thing, probably in the entire banking industry, we are the only ones who are directly engaging with the venture capitals or maybe that kind of a new startups. Right now, almost our book has reached close to around 120 crores of investments, and we are making quite a lot of a progress. And when I look into this entire startups as a kind of business, there is a substantial scope. And how many of them will ultimately graduate or something is different. But at the same time, the valuations will go up, and it is these startups have got a niche technology, niche kind of a products, which will address the specific needs of a particular geographies or a particular set of farmers. So in that way, it is doing very well. But here, only one thing I would like to say, because now I have gone through the whole of this gamut of the startups, really 3,160, whatever ghosts are told. If you just go into the drill down to that details, I think most of them are the techno-based, information-based kind of a startups. Basically, the similar Uber platform is getting extrapolated for doing various works, and somebody is supplying the fertilizer, somebody the pesticide, somebody is doing the aggregation, somebody is doing something else. But thing is, are they adding any value to the science? Actually, this is a very fundamental thing which I feel. Now, every time I go through one website, probably you also might know the AG Funder, if you see that website. And the way the startups are going abroad and the way the startups are going in India, there's a fundamental difference. We are almost 20 years behind the things that are happening in the West, particularly with regard to the technology, creating new techno products which are very production efficient, and the productivity levels will go up, which will benefit the farmer. So there should be a shift, because this is a bread and butter. Okay, now financing the present startups, but thing is, there should be a concerted effort on the part of everyone, that is all the banking industry and everyone, to go into that kind of a technological cutting edge technologies. Even if we invest more, and probably sometimes it may result in a little bit kind of a benefit, but a time may come, actually our technologies will rule the roost. So that is where I think we have to work on it.
Thank you, Dr. Chittal. I think exciting set of answers. The fact that NABARD is willing to take leadership on the value chain side, and of course it has done quite a bit on the FPOs. I think the banking sector getting together and trying to exchange knowledge, their experiences and practices, has everything that will be a positive outcome arising from there. Miraji, this is the last question from me for the panel. Afterward, we have got a few audience questions that have come in. I think if I had done quite a few development projects with bank credit linkage, are there any successful experiences that are there that you might like to just briefly indicate? And also, what is the level of challenge in taking these pilots to scale? Meaning, if they are good, are we in a position to really take it to scale, making it adopted as mainstream products or processes?
Mr. Srinivasan, you know the work that IFAD does in terms of our first generation projects. In a way, the previous lot of projects that we did in the 1990s and the 2000s focused very much on the SHG bank linkage kind of model, and we are now more and more focused towards commercialization of smallholder farmers. Now, the thing is that all IFIs in a large country like India, we finance innovations in general. The very design, the very purpose of IFIs is to finance something that is innovative. So sometimes the whole project itself might be innovative, or elements of the project would be innovative. For example, NABARD may be familiar with this. The IFAD finance project Tejaswini in Maharashtra introduced the concept of self-sustaining community institutions with members paying their fee for services. This was introduced, and it created the basis for very strong SHG bank linkage which sustained post project and still continues till date. Now, of course, IFAD has a new project with the MAVIM, the implementing agency there. But for the intervening 2-3 years, this continued to have very, very effective bank linkage with private sector banks, particularly ICICI leading the bank financing. So it showed that there is a potential for creating these self-sustaining community institutions. It also showed that poor women are also willing to pay for services if they get good services in terms of, you know, access to bank loans, which was what was being done through this. And it was done at a scale of 1 million households. So there is the scope for scaling this up. And now also some of the things that that IFIs do is that, you know, within our projects, we create flexible funding for attracting innovators, you know, like a challenge fund or an innovation fund. One of the things that we has proved to be a good platform for attracting innovations or supporting a range of different innovators is the approach of multi-stakeholder platforms. And I think this is picking up across board. This is where we bring together the communities who are able to clearly articulate their requirements together with the fintechs, the agtechs, the government, the support services, so that everyone is aware of the full picture and it is not a fragmented image. So the finance people know that these are the services that the farmers is able to get, and the farmer knows that together with the financing support, they can also get these technical support. And so the whole picture is out there, and this leads to more innovators getting interested in working with farmers. This is now being something that is being done in Nepal, in India, and in other countries as well. IFAD is now very much interested in its private sector strategy to start some non-sovereign operations where we are looking at risk-sharing facilities. And some pilots have started in Africa, and we are looking at identifying a good model also in India. Of course, there have been experiences of scaling up, not particularly of the bank financing kind of model, but scaling up of small ideas. For example, the NERCOMP model that was financed by IFAD in the Northeast was scaled up by the World Bank and Government of India across many Northeastern states in the name of the Northeast Rural Livelihood Project. So that was a big scale up. At a much smaller level, the mobile chain link fencing that was introduced by the farmers to ward off man-animal conflict was scaled up by the government of Uttarakhand across the whole state. So, the whole scaling up thing actually depends on, having the right evidence, having a great idea, having a compelling story with the evidence, and then the ability to leverage additional resources from a range of different sources. Could be other multilaterals, could be government, and could be private sector. So, there's no straightforward, simple story to tell here, but, different things that have been happening. But certainly, innovation is very much at the heart of the work that most multilaterals do with the government in the country. Over.
Thank you, Meera. I think, there are problems in taking pilots to scale, but then the good ideas in the right place, they get scaled up. Governments adopt it. But they seem to be more in the non-financial aspects of what the multilaterals do. Financial aspects, banks have to maybe balance the initiative with their own risk perception and sustainability of the product. There are a few questions from the audience. First, I will offer the question to Dr. Chintala. There is this program of making primary agricultural credit societies into multi-purpose societies. So what is the expected outcome of this initiative and what might be the impact of this on agricultural credit proper? Professor Ravichandran from Gandhigram Rural Institute wants to know.
First of all, this is a NABARD, I think in 2014-15, we experimented with this kind of converting some of the primary societies to multi-service societies. So this is to give a kind of a scale and also a diversification of their business. So now this is the one which we did it. And subsequently, last year, what we have done was actually having seen the success, particularly in Karnataka and some parts of Andhra Pradesh and few other places, we found that actually the primary societies which are otherwise languishing only to do a small business of the crop loan, actually not having anything. Actually, they need to go for a different kind of a business plan. So now that is where actually we try to do this one. So the scheme was devised in such a way that in country we are having close to around 100,000 primary societies, of which almost 65,000 societies are extremely good. And the 35,000 societies are very, very good. So now our entire target was to just go into this, at least bringing these 35,000 societies into this kind of a multi-service society. So we started the program in such a way that NABARD would give refinance up to 2 crores at 4%. Then subsequently, we have negotiated with the government of India where that under the Agri Infra Fund of that 1 lakh crore, that Agri Infra Fund has got a 3% interest subvention. So we have dovetailed that subvention to this one. So now these primary societies are getting money at just 1%. So now this is the first thing that is happening. Now, really, what are the activities they are doing? And to take the case, right now, already 3,500 primary societies have already got sanctions from NABARD. And now some of them are creating godowns, some of them are creating cold storages, some of them are creating the processing, a mini processing kind of thing, some of them are creating the aggregating units, some are creating the logistics. And actually the other day I was in Mizoram and these primary societies are doing a great job because there the agriculture happens somewhere in very distant hills and the produce has to be brought down to the main markets like Aizwal and other things. Actually that there are no other way of conveying it to the market. So now these primary societies have taken that mobile vans. It's a logistics so that they will do. So now the farmers are getting them. So now this is a very, very great thing that is happening. And we are very confident in the next 3 or 4 years, at least 30 to 35,000 primary societies are going to be converted from the primary activities to the multi-activities. This is the one. And the second thing is that once the computerization is being kick-started right now, the computerization of PACs, which was in the cold storage, now already it is gaining attention. In case if that happens, all the transactions that happen at that primary society level will get reflected everywhere in the CBS systems of the CCB, SCB, and also the NABARD and others, so that there is a transparency will come into this one. And the moment that data transparency comes, it leads to the governance. So our entire thing is a kind of a coordinated effort to make the primary societies as the real farmer contact, the last mile kind of an organizations, and they should work with the same efficiency of the any other commercial bank branch so that actually that can happen. And they should have a bouquet of products to offer and for the community, whatever is the requirement of the community. So now that is why this PACS to MSEs, which we call, actually the scheme has been designed, being rolled out. And also for the information of the audience, I'll say that now some of the states like Andhra Pradesh, Telangana, and maybe some of the few other states like Orissa also, and UP, the governments are giving a piece of land to these primary societies to construct the godowns and also other structures. So now the governments are also coming in a big way to take this benefit of this kind of thing and create that kind of a vibrant primary societies at the ground level.
Thank you, Dr. Sintal. It's heartening to know that almost 1/3 of all PACs will now come into the multi-service format and then be able to do a variety of things for their members. There is another anonymous question, but a very interesting one. This is to you, Dr. Ghosh. Government has several schemes which are focused on allied sector, whether it is fisheries, poultry, dairy, even forestry and all that. But then in terms of capital allocation from banking system, they do not seem to enjoy as much a preference as agriculture does. What is it that, is there any mechanism in SBI when you do the planning for deployment, especially for capital formation in the allied sector?
No, I think for allied activities, We do have a system, but the system, for example, I think the interesting point to note is that I think, as you know, Digati, because of this value capturing, the India has significantly moved to the allied activities per se, and that is also reflected in the data. So we are actually, and there has a lot of initiatives that the government has introduced, starting from livestock, starting from fisheries, starting from bamboo cultivation, starting from the export promoter and northeast. And we are glad that we are exploring several initiatives. It is just that I think the reorientation of the lending portfolio of the banking sector is now progressing, because for long we have been, there has been a focus toward these the crop loans only, and for several reasons. But I think that is going to change right now, because there is a fundamental perception which has also been built in the minds of the agricultural, in the farmers, that if you have a better borrowing history, you'll be able to get a better terms of credit from the banks. And this we have seen, and this behavioral change in behavioral aspect is actually very encouraging. And the good thing is that the agricultural sector, as all of us know, was the bedrock during the pandemic when all other sectors collapsed. Agriculture sector was one of the only sector that expanded during the pandemic. And my sense is that without any government support, these sectors can go at 3 to 4%. But for a country like India, which is growing right now, but for a country like India to have a sustainable development of agriculture, this has to go up to at least 5%. So my sense is, yes, the banks are doing. We, for example, to give you a specific example, we have the government is running an, I think, scheme from the Northeast sector. I am the scheme. We are now actively participating in that scheme, and we are, our reorientation is also getting towards more of value chain financing rather than typically crop loan financing, which has been the mainstay of the lending portfolio.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Now I am coming to the last question.
Can I have a say?
I want to conclude slightly earlier than one, because there is still a book release segment that is there. Dr. Chintala.
Take a quick now, minute. Whatever Ghosh Saab has told, actually there is a little more also we can add. Now, allied activities were doing very well, and also they are still doing very well. But at the same time, as you are telling, for quite some time, actually there was no exclusive kind of earmarking. But now, with the new ministry, that agriculture ministry has been bifurcated, and now that animal husbandry and fisheries ministry has come. Now, last year they have done exclusive KCC for the animal husbandry and fisheries. And also, if I look into the budget, actually just now we had discussed. Now, around 60,000 crores has been specifically earmarked for the animal husbandry and the fisheries sector. And till now, I think by November 30th, close to around 41,000 crores has already been flown to this kind of a sector. So now, a kind of a directed approach is happening with regard to the animal husbandry and fisheries. And the remaining sectors also, now actually for forestry and others, though there are a plethora of schemes, but thing is, this kind of a directed effort is must for doing this kind of thing. Now the fisheries is one of the major export item also, and also with the domestic level of livelihood, actually that is creating quite a lot of economy around it. So now the government has realized that. So now, and also the DEDA scheme, actually just last year they stopped. Otherwise, that was the one which created quite a lot of a benefit to the customer, farmers at the ground level. And the other way, the good thing that the government had done after that Atmanirbhar time is that creating an animal husbandry infrastructure development fund. Like AIF type, like AIF is 1 lakh crores, and this AHIDF is a 15,000 crore fund in which 50% of interest subvention government is giving. And besides that, actually, they told that now a credit guarantee is given. So now NABARD has already started NAB Samrakshan Trustee, of which AHIDF is a kind of a credit guarantee which you are giving. So now the moment actually a processing industry, whether it is a dairy or a abattoir or maybe any kind of a thing comes at one level, actually downstream activities by the farmers will automatically develop, because only captive markets will generate. So that is how now the direction, as what we are telling us already, it is happening, and it needs to be further beefed up, because now every year government wants to create that kind of exclusive segmentation of these sectors. And I think this is a good development that had happened in the last 1 or 2 years.
Thank you for all those details and the other actions that government is taking apart from banks are to do. The last question that actually is about you have about 1 minute to say what are your three priorities in agricultural finance. They could be just one phrase, but in that, can you also specify, is climate resilient agriculture one of your priority issues? Yeah, Meera ji, go ahead.
For us, I would say that instituting a strong credit discipline is a key priority, because this ensures sustainable, credit flows between banks and farmers. And, as a building block for this, creating strong community institutions with good governance structures, this also helps to engender the investments. And climate is on top priority of EFAD's work, and instruments for climate financing are being worked upon. Over from my side.
Thank you, Mir. Dr. Ghosh?
I think has been said, I agree with that one. I think credit discipline is one of the most important aspects of this behavior. And my sense is that it will be better. We have actually given out some suggestions. We had given out 5 suggestions for actually making the agricultural sector more vibrant in the next couple of years after the abolition, after the farm laws actually has again been repealed. But in my sense, I think what is important is that we should understand that credit discipline is the most important thing. And as long as this is not becomes the cornerstone, it will be only the borrowers who will be losing out in terms of the loan, because there are all benefits on the table. There is an agricultural subvention which the government is getting, where you can get loan up to, at prohibitively low rates of interest. You have the system whereby you are getting a Kishan credit, the Prime Minister Kishan scheme from the government. So you have all support from the government. So I think it's high time that if there is some element of discipline in the borrower portfolio, and we get rid of, honestly, I'm saying it, that we must get rid of all these popular schemes like loan waiver, which is nothing but politically sensitive issues, which we must try to avoid. Because we have seen, as I have said to you in the past, that during 2014 to 18, actually the institutional sources declined because of huge loan waiver, which has thankfully has now been reversed. So these are some of the things which we must, policymakers must ensure, and let the portfolio, agricultural portfolio, reorient towards the necessities of what Bharat wants today and not what the others want.
Thank you, Dr. Ghosh. Dr. Chintala, what are your 3 priorities? Yes. You will have many more, I know. You have to prioritize within them.
Yeah. Now, one is first thing I would like to say that ecosystem now has got all the ingredients. It got institutions, it got the credit flow, it got the suppliers, it got everything. So now, doing with all these things, what is happening is that farmers are producing whatever they would like to produce, and ultimately forcing the governments or the states to procure and going to this kind of. So now, my priority, and which we are articulating everywhere, is that the agriculture should go into a kind of a customer-centric, profit-oriented, climate-resilient kind of an approach, and the collectivization as the maybe a kind of underlying platform for doing all the things. Then the next one is that agriculture should really now go into a kind of export orientation in a big way. And for that, one is with regard to the good agricultural practices protocols, which we have to evolve in consultation with the importing countries' requirements, EPEDA, or maybe all kinds of ICR, so many institutions. But the export orientation is a must, and whatever is there, so that the kind of a cobweb syndrome which we see, maybe the seesaw kind of thing. 1 year it will be excess and 1 year below. All these things can be curtailed. And the third one is that now the technology incorporation in the entire agricultural production process, which will reduce not only the drudgery but also the cost. Actually, now this is the one which we have to do it. Now, if we put all these things, the remaining systems are already there. Actually, we have banks to do the things, and the moment actually the agriculture becomes profitable, a particular client is good, actually banks will rush to give him money. So actually we need not worry much about the banks. And now juxtaposing all the developments that are happening in the technology and the financial inclusion onto the agricultural lending to make this agriculture with this kind of a profit oriented and customer centric is going to ease the requirement right now, and we are all chugging towards that.
Can I come for a minute? Can I just come for a minute?
30 seconds.
Okay, 30 seconds. So very quickly, I mean, as I think, Jay, I just wanted to add 2-3 points of making agriculture viable. The first thing I think is that make the government insert a quantity guarantee instead of an MSP. You have been arguing for that. That could be the most effective. Second thing is that I think the apart from the APMC market infrastructure, one extremely important suggestion which we are making is that there should be an establishment of a contract farming institution in India. And finally, which you have said is that revisit the KCC portfolio of the banks, allow banks the operational freedom to reorient the portfolio, which can lead to an increase in the farmers' income.
Fantastic. I think it had been a very engaging 90 minutes of discussion. Let me summarize this in a couple of minutes in my own interest. We require a good, robust institutional base in order for agricultural credit to flow. Credit discipline is an important requirement all over. And what Dr. Chintala was saying, customer center. Which also implies that there should be aggregation. So we are thinking the new age agricultural finance will focus on aggregators like FPOs, agricultural enterprises which procure in bulk, also startups, the agri-techs, the fintechs which work in the rural area, a whole lot of new players as well as new processes, the value chain part to discuss. If you put up a word cloud is agri-tech, FPOs, aggregation, value chain, point that Dr. Ghosh brought out at the end. The incentive that we offer here should be correct and not perverse, like he pointed out, especially the case of waivers. The operational freedom to figure out how best to do agricultural finance, not to railroad institutions into single products. That's the key, this thing. I think the overall, the mode is that there is an incremental growth in agricultural credit. There is an incremental institutional interest in agricultural credit, even during a pandemic year when every other sector suffered in terms of weak flows. Agriculture gained agricultural, what you call credit flows, much better than anyone else. And it was a positive growth in, that's what RBI also reports. So building on this positive momentum, probably we are in a better place, but there is a lot more work to be done in terms of institutionalizing some of the existing good practices. I would stop here and thank you all for the keen involvement in the panel and also the audience for their questions. Arya, now I turn it over to you for your part of the work. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Chintala, Dr. Ghosh, Meera and Srinivasan sir for a very insightful discussion. We had a couple of engaging questions from the audience as well. So we thank you for all the insights that you shared with us. We'll now begin the release of the State of Agri Financing in India book. The book is authored by N. Srinivasan and is supported by NABARD. I would request Dr. Chintala to kindly unwrap the book and show, and request the team as well to show the cover up. The book provides rich information on policy landscape and institutional architecture for agri financing, the directional focus of policymakers, emerging trends, and green shoots for revival of a stressed farming sector. It is a single reference book which summarizes the current state of agri-finance in India. It highlights policy blind spots, gray areas, and documents important advancement made in agri-finance space in last couple of years. The book is supported by NABARD. And now I would request Dr. Chintala to say a few words on the book.
The book has been given now. I don't know how to say a few words, but definitely, because we know Srinivasan Saab and the kind of work he puts into writing the books and other things. And this data, I will go through it now the whole night. Actually, tonight itself, I will read it. But going by the content, actually, that has been given this one, really, how the agriculture is faring in the entire country. Actually, we have come up over a long period of time, actually quite a lot of developments have taken place in the agriculture sector. And the country as a whole has gone up from 40-50 million tons to close to 310 million tons, and a plethora of other products also we are producing. But at the same time, the ensuring the profitability of farming is still a mirage. Actually, that is where I think now all of us have to work. And I hope that this book has covered this one, because now quantum by supply side, with quite a lot of credit is going, and also so many other things are happening. But at the same time, whether all of them are adding a kind of a profitability to the farmer. So now that is also probably must have been covered. And I have not just gone through it, but otherwise, if I just go through it, then he has covered the startups, he has covered the demand side factors, supply side factors, and also how the various institutions and their architecture is adding to the efficiency of the credit delivery. So these are all the things actually which are very essential, because in the beginning also we were telling that it's not the lack of money, it's not lack of will of national institutions that they are not financing farmers in some geographies. It is because the fundamentally there is no kind of ecosystem there which is enabling this kind of a movement to come. Otherwise, actually, that everybody would rush to such kind of a places to finance. So now, the state of agricultural finance definitely might have covered all the things, how the skewedness has come in the country and what are the factors affecting it. Probably what are the remedies actually which we can take it, and if that is the case, is it a political will also is required? So really how the things are done, and what are the infrastructural requirements? Now, some other places do not have the irrigation, some other places do not have connectivity, so you cannot even push more credit despite your willingness. So now all these things are probably might have incorporated, and definitely it's going to be a treatise, and as I'm telling that I am going to read it overnight. And if you can ask the same question tomorrow, I will answer for almost an hour. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, esteemed panelists, for your time. We enjoyed the discussion, and we hope our delegates too enjoyed it. We sincerely thank a lot for finding time from your busy schedule. We shall now close the session. Dear delegates, we again thank you for joining us. The next session is in Hall B. We request you to...
Thank you, Gosab. Mera
Mera. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you, Miraji. Thank you, Goji. Thank you, Dr. Chintala. Yes.
Thank you,
Arya.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good to meet you all online.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you.